fight fans. Fight's gonna get underway shortly here. Just wanna give a thanks to our sponsors. Omega Presents, Liberty Title. Gold and Diamonds. 612 as Dave. The Poorhouse. And the official Fight Night after party is at the Poorhouse following the main event. Butcher and the Boar, Fieldstone Family Home, Little Caesars, home of the $5 pizza, Northeast, the Moose Bar, Mach 1.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Minneapolis Convention Center as Omega presents Truax versus Banner. And we're live as we get set for seven bouts of boxing. Doug Erline and my tag team partner in crime tonight, the common man, Dan Cole. And Dan, this thing is obviously at the top headline by a main event that'll watch Matt Banda, one of the, I would say, if you put everything together from a package perspective, he's put more butts in Minnesota boxing seats and venues than anybody in the last 20 years. It's his last fight. He rides off into the sunset here tonight.
Yeah, he has.
Or blows away.
Well, there you go. He's meant a lot to Minnesota boxing over the years, Matt. Started, as you say, 20 years. He's got almost closing in on 60 fights as a professional. He pride the East Side. They love him. You can see they travel well again. He's got a huge crowd here for his final fight. He's done it all. I mean, when you main event at Madison Square Garden, I don't care what they say, that means you're a hell of a fighter, because they don't just let anybody main event at Madison Square Garden with fought John Duddy. He's been in the ring with a lot of great fighters. Julio Chavez Jr. twice, John Duddy, beat Dory Boy Campos for that IBA title. Banda's been in with a lot of guys. He always comes to fight. He's gotten better as the years have gone by. He's become a better boxer, a better fighter, crafter, smarter. The one thing that's always, I think, been his downfall is he's never been a really, really good puncher. Had Banda had real punching power, I think he could have been a top 10 contender. He wants to win tonight. I just went backstage and talked to him before. He did say, and they all said it, so again, until they never lace him up again, you won't know. But he said, this is it for me. This is my last fight, and I want to go out a winner. So it should be a really good night.
It's funny because you talk about Matt Banda and his career, and we'll talk a whole bunch about that as the night goes along. But I haven't seen him this driven or this motivated to step inside a ring for a while. And it might have been back in 2007, January 12th to be exact, and you were there when he fought the Bullet. And that was a little bit different scenario because obviously there was the hatred there. But I haven't seen him as motivated as he is tonight.
He told me that he thought Truax said some things that didn't sit well with him. I don't know, I didn't hear what the comments were, but he is motivated, and any guy that, we've seen so many fighters say this is it, and then they come back and fight again. But I think a lot of them do go into that, their supposed last fight, and they really mean it's their last fight, so they want to go out a winner. So you're right, the drive, the attitude, I'm sure, is there. You don't want to fight your last fight and lose. I did say this to Matt. I said, I do know one thing. No matter what happens tonight, you're going to give him everything you got. You're going to go out on your shield if he loses, and that's exactly, he agreed completely. I mean, he's not going to come in there and think, I'm behind on, I know I'm behind on the scorecards. I'll just hang on and go out, I'll stand on my feet. If he's going to go out, he'll go out on his shield. So,
let's talk about the Minnesota middleweight champion, Caleb Golden Truax. Really turned the corner from a career perspective when he fought Jermaine Taylor. When you're in with a guy that is a former world champion from a confidence perspective, it really changed the way that he approached this game, didn't it?
I think he told you, he told a radio audience of mine on my weekday radio show, after that fight, then he knew that, hey, I can hang with the big boys, I can bang with them. And until you do that, until you step up and fight with a world-class fighter, you really don't know. You think you can, you talk big, you beat guys in your hometown, you've had a lot of success, but until you step in that ring in Vegas or whatever it might be and you're fighting a world-class guy, former title holder, until you go in there and go toe-to-toe with him and take everything he's got, you really don't know. And that made him believe, and since that fight, every fight I've seen him, he looks as confident as any fighter. He really believes in himself, and I think that's half the battle.
We're ready to go here tonight as we get you set for the opening bout. Let's send it up to our ring announcer, Mike Melick.
Good time! Is now! Our first bout of the evening will be four rounds in the lightweight division. Introducing first, in the red corner, standing 5 feet, 4 inches tall, weighing in at 132 pounds, and fighting out of Indianapolis, Indiana! He's holding a record of 2 wins and 7 losses with 1 knockout. He is Dwayne King Quista! And his opponent in the blue corner, standing 5 feet 9 inches tall, weighing in at 134 pounds, and fighting out of St. Paul, Minnesota. He represents Coon Rapids and Local Lights Gym, and holding one of the 9 wins, 5 losses with 5 knockouts. He is the German Lights.
Set. Jeremy lights out McLaurin and Dwayne Wisdom, and Dan, I like this kid McLaurin. He's 9-5 with 5 knockouts. He's a slick fighter.
Yeah, he's got a ton of talent. He got a nice build, you know, long, lanky, got good reach, hit pretty hard, got a decent chin. Yeah, he's a good fighter. Obviously, we've not seen the Dwayne Wisdom kid with a 2-7 record, only 1 knockout. Doesn't seem like he'll present, you know, much problem for McLaurin as the fight goes on, but you never know, we'll have to see.
Early on, Wisdom trying to get inside and work the body, and some success as he's throwing punches and punches early on. And McLaurin trying to battle back, caught up against the ropes, and now McLaurin takes a shot and gets his right arm caught in that middle rope as Wisdom, if nothing else, might burn himself out here in round number one. This one's set for 4, the first of 7 fights here tonight.
Slide on the
referee
ropes.
Mark Nelson Those steps in slide and the separates ropes. The two, and McLaurin will try to test that left jab. Jeremy McLaurin, St. Paul, sends a nice left, and now both fighters tied up. And
Wisdom kid does what a lot of counters do, comes out right away to say, hey, you know, let's see what the hometown kid's got. I'm here to lose, so I'm going to have some fun. And so, not that he's been hired to lose, you know, obviously, but he's going to come out here and see if he can win this fight tonight.
And Wisdom, the aggressor here in round number one, as McLaurin sends an overhand right.
Hands free, guys.
He's got the height advantage. He needs to really work that jab and put that jab out there just to kind of keep him at bay.
Wisdom is a southpaw, which gives, you know, a conventional fighter a little bit of trouble. A little shorter, less reach. He's is getting inside, he's doing what he's supposed to do, and he's landed some punches, but nothing that's done any damage to McLaurin.
Really doing a good job, Dan, of getting inside.
Work that jab.
You hear it all the time, and from a fight circle perspective, and a fighter that's taller and has a definite reach advantage, that smaller guy, that shorter guy, got to try to get into his kitchen. McLaurin now working the body to some success. That's a nice
turn. Missed with the right hand.
Yep.
Wisdom counter with a nice left to the body.
And we've seen that. It's interesting tonight. One of the subplots, you see guys go for the head. I'm impressed that people are really, these fighters are really trying to work the body and really trying to break guys down.
Well, and that goes back to the work in the gym and who your trainer is, how experienced they are. You know, a lot of these guys
work out of there.
You know, their trainers just learn the trade as well. So sometimes they don't know as much, and then sometimes they don't listen to them either. You know, guys like to headhunt. They're looking for knockouts, and sometimes they forget that. You work the body, slow them down. You got a pretty good opportunity to loosen the guy up, and then you can do your damage upstairs later.
It's the end of round one. A round that's plenty of action. And it's a good thing that this thing's only scheduled for 4, because Wisdom right out of gas. If you take a look at the replay here. You always get that early. You always get that early return to try to get the feeling out process as they try to roll along. And McLaurin really needs to kind of find his space a little bit here in the second round. We'll see if he can do that. Really work that jab as we head to round number 2.
I like the Wisdom kid too, though. You can tell he's experienced, whether it's experience has come in the pros or the amateurs, but he has a nice job behind
4 in McLaurin. Sends a right out of the gate, and Wisdom working backwards here early in round 2. She's trying to set that jab. There he comes at it. Has Wisdom in the ropes, and now he works the body. A couple nice shots there, and now Wisdom's got him pinned back up against the ropes. Smart fighter, this Wisdom. Early on.
Punch and get out, punch and get out.
You hear Mark Nelson yelling, punch and get out, punch and get out. McLaurin trying to turn him. Now Nelson gonna jump in there and separate him. That overhand shot, that one missed the mark by Jeremy. They tie up once again.
You could hear
the corner of McLaurin saying, jump in, don't give him a chance.
Yeah, I mean, McLaurin's doing the right job by trying to cut off the ring. Wisdom keeps trying to move away from his right hand, and McLaurin is stalking him, but he's not throwing any punches. At least his corner doesn't think so.
Right.
Agree.
Oh, there's a nice shot by Wisdom. Got him with a left. Jeremy going to walk him back down again. This one scheduled for 4. Our first bout of the evening in the lightweight division. McLaurin.
Step back. Step out and go.
Throws that left hand, now comes over the top of the right. Gets a little grin out of Wisdom.
Up. Keep working.
All right, Wisdom's dropped his gloves in this later stages of this round, Dan, and he's leaving his...
Yeah, it was a good lead right hand by McLaurin there. I don't think Wisdom saw it coming. I'm assuming he was expecting a jab, and McLaurin hit him right on the number.
You gotta fire it though. Fire it up the middle. Up the gut. Now.
Wisdom's doing a good job of taking away space, but here comes McLaurin, and he's got him in the corner. And Jeremy going to work. And that's a veteran fighter move there as Wisdom ties him up.
He's wearing down. Let's go.
You hear Tom Alstead in the corner of Jeremy McLaurin. He's wearing down.
Step outside.
Wisdom coming back in the later stages of the round.
Punch out of there. Get out on your own.
Nice defensive work by McLaurin, too.
Absolutely.
None of those punches did any damage, mostly on the arm.
Time! And round 2. That was a good round by McLaurin. As you see him early on, he tried to set that jab up, Dan, and did a good job early in the round. And then again, it was just kind of one of those, Wisdom just kind of tied him up smartly. I think that he's got him scouted really well.
There was that right hand I was talking about.
Yep.
Instead of the jab, because he'd been throwing the jab so often, I think Wisdom was expecting
a shot, taking away space.
Right here,
but McLaurin, he's got him in the corner. Jeremy, going to work.
When he had him up in that corner, he was landing a few of those, but Wisdom did a pretty good job of ducking his head, keeping out of the way, smothering the punches, and finally tying him up.
Round number 3.
Fire.
Dwayne Wisdom out of Indianapolis, Indiana. Jeremy McLaurin out of St. Paul. He sent a couple jabs and then came back with a right. Oh, that's the danger there. He left himself wide open, and here comes Wisdom. And Jeremy looks at him and shakes his head and goes back to work.
Yeah, but those were definitely scoring punches. Yeah. I mean, they may not have hurt McLaurin, but they were. That was maybe his best combination of the
night. Step out. Around.
Wisdom. McLaurin back into the corner once again. From a strategy perspective, Wisdom has done a good job. He may be behind in the scorecards, but he's done a good job not letting McLaurin get going.
Only issue 4.
Step out.
for Wisdom, though, as you can see with the one knockout.
Right.
He doesn't have any power, so I don't think the floor really has anything to worry about there. So.
Yeah, I think we found that out.
Wisdom got to start winning rounds.
Right.
It's already the third, so best case, I think he gets a draw because I'm certain he lost the first two.
Correct. But I think we found that out when he came out just throwing everything at him and just didn't even, I didn't connect or, all right, you're spending a lot of energy.
Like I say, probably his best strategy comes out here. He's the opponent.
Right.
He says, well, let's see what this kid's got. I'll just come run at him. You know, he knows the kid's record, 9-5. I'll run at him and see what he's made out of, but then he could see McLaurin know what he's doing.
McLaurin working the body, and now Wisdom comes back with a few of his own. Comes back in an overhand right, and has McLaurin up against the ropes. But again, it's almost an angle and a leverage thing. It's like Wisdom has to jump in order to throw a punch. McLaurin flips the script and turns him around. Now Mark Nelson will separate him and we'll go back at it. Round number three at the Minneapolis Convention Center. Wisdom with an overhand right. And now McLaurin comes back with a couple of his own.
Down now.
There's a good body shot. He's in familiar territory once again as Wisdom with his backs up against the rope.
Behind that jab. Up and over. Now.
Now he's throwing punches. Now he's got him in the corner. And Wisdom, just as he's done every time he's been in trouble, he's come back with a couple of his own.
Step out.
And that's the end of the third.
You tell me if you think this is an apt description of Dwayne Wisdom, and he got guys like this all over the country. I think he's a hobby fighter.
Yeah.
He does it because he likes to. He likes to get in the ring, make a couple extra dollars, yep. Travel a little bit. Because obviously, a 2-7 with one knockout, he's not going anywhere. But he likes the competition. He likes to get in there. Like I say, he comes in here. First thing he does, he runs across the room and says, "This guy right away, so he's got." Sees the other guy has some defensive capabilities, can land himself. He goes, "Okay, I'll just go in there." For him, I'm sure he's treated almost like a glorified sparring session. Let's just see if I can land some punches. Do the best I can defensively, and if not, it happens. He's got some skills, but he's just not as good as McLaurin. I don't think he's pushing.
Would you invite Henry Lake to the left of you over here, or what?
Henry Lake's here.
You know it's a big event.
You know it's a big event when Henry Lake comes. There's no
Lake is in the building.
He watches the sweet signs once in a while, but it's got to be a big one for him, and he's here to see a true axe versus Vandal, that's for sure.
Final round of this opening contest between Jeremy McLaurin and Dwayne Wisdom. I think your description was right on as it pertains to Wisdom. I think that you hit it dead on the nuts.
Yeah, I've never heard of it phrased that way either. I just thought of, you know, hobby fighters,
right.
Guys that like to get in the ring and love fights. There's all kinds. There's guys in this town that do the same thing, too.
I can think of about 100 things I'd rather do than to get hit in the face. Yeah,
me too, but some of these guys just have that competitive drive, and they're tough guys.
Yep.
They're really tough guys, and they think they're tougher than the other guy.
Right.
And they like to prove. They think their talent is going to get them through fights, and in a lot of cases, it does.
Well, we'll talk about at the end of this thing what McLaurin thinks he got out of this and learned. I think the fact that he's, you know, in there with the South, he's going to take a lot. I mean, he's going to be able to gain a lot out of this film watching it back, no question.
On again with Jeremy too. I don't know him.
Right.
I'm not sure what his
long-term
plans are. He's sort of a hobby fighter, but thinks he can still do something big time in the sport of boxing. But when you're 9-5, it's so hard to do that because there's so many guys out there, and the networks love undefeated people and promoters and matchmakers like undefeated fighters. It's hard to get any fights, you know, climb up that ladder at 9-5. But he's a good boxer. I like him. I think he's got some skills.
Great, don't punch. Mark Nelson steps in and separates the fighters about the midway point of round number four.
Let him go.
Now this has been more of a wrestling hog tie type of a scenario than anything else. There's not a lot of boxing going on, which is, I think, what probably what Wisdom's game plan was all along. I talked to Jeremy last night at the weigh-ins, and I said, you're going to put on a show? And he said, absolutely. And part of the problem is I just don't think he's had the opportunity to. He's just not been able to let his hands go. Because Wisdom's playing pretty good defense.
Yeah, and Wisdom knows what, I mean, he's now, I mean, he knows it's a lost cause, so he's just trying to bull forward, try to land a few punches, and get tied up, minimize the damage to himself, and, you know, maybe land a punch and change the flow of the fight.
Warren working right in front of you. The best seat in the house, wherever you're watching here tonight.
Go. There you go.
Tom Halstead yelling out instructions. The left jab stuck out there by McLaurin. And that's it.
Yeah, I would think we called that a pretty lopsided decision, too. I suppose you could see somewhere in there in the first round, maybe.
I like what he did in the first round. I mean, as far as coming out and being busy, who knows how many of those actually landed. But you said it best when you talked about you got nothing to lose. You're the opponent. Test the water, see what you got.
Here in Minnesota, right now tonight, we've got three really good veteran judges, too. Denny Nelson, Jim Peralt, and John Mariano. They've watched hundreds and hundreds.
Denny Nelson probably won
1,000.
Yeah.
Judging him, repping him. I mean, he's great. I think Denny's done refereeing 70 or 80 fights. So he's been around. These guys know how to judge fights.
Absolutely. So we wait for the official decision. One of the things that I was going to ask you about, when you got a fighter this is his 15th fight. And so it looked to me like McLaurin was a little gassed there in the end. And for a guy who's been in 15 fights, to only be going four, if you want to take that next step up, six, I don't know if McLaurin's got the wind or the gas or the work ethic to work up to that. I mean, that's one of the best things. That's going to be a question we're going to have to ask if he wants to take that next step.
Well, and then I don't know. He knows who his opponent is. He knows his opponent's probably not going to present much of a problem. So then how serious does he take his training as he gets ready for a fight? And I'm not accusing him that he didn't. I'm just saying I don't know. I know if I got what I think is a pretty winnable fight, I might, the edge might not quite be
there.
But every time I've seen McLaurin fight, he earns his fights, and nothing ever really comes easy for him, too.
This fight was brought to you by Mach 1 Car Audio and Security, with four convenient locations to serve you. And we appreciate all our sponsors here helping us out. We appreciate you tuning in tonight, wherever you may be. As we've got just a grand night of boxing here on a gorgeous Saturday day. And then the wind decided January wanted to jump in and turn it into a minus 50 with a 50 mile an hour wind scenario. As we head upstairs, the ring announcer Mike.
After the completion of four rounds, the judges have made their decision. All judges scoring about 39-37. And winner by unanimous decision, Jermaine Whiteside!
So McLaurin picks up the win, and I think that, you know, it's probably exactly what we thought. It was, you know, a 3-1 deal. And
yeah, they gave probably the boys in the first round.
Right.
And then everyone kind of just methodically won the next three. Wisdom tried to, you know, win ugly, you know, tie him up, get close. And all three judges saw the exact same way. That's about the five.
Jeremy, great fight. How are you feeling right now?
I'm feeling good. You know, I'm feeling good. Looking to get into the next one. This dude is a tough softball. I used to fight in softball, but I landed some good right hands. You know, and putting some work in the best combinations.
You know, Dwayne's record was 2-7. He definitely does not represent that. He was a tough competitor.
Yeah, he was tough. He was tough. He slipped. I knew that coming into the fight. You know, I was looking to get back in here with a soft feet. I can miss prop, but he needs to get back in the gym and work harder. he did a very wonderful job. And, you know, I got to ask, it's been a while since you've been in the ring, right?
Yeah, my last fight here was against Gary Hager. He was 8-1 with 6 knockouts. Everybody had him going to knock me out. I went to an his decision on that. So I put my hand off to him. He wants to fight me again. I'll fight him in better shape. Beat the shit out of him.
All right, Jeremy. Well, hey, I gotta say, it's good to see you. I think every fight I've announced for you, you've won. Yeah. So let's just keep this going. Let's stick together.
Let's tune in the ring with you,
baby. All right, Jeremy. Well, hey, anybody else can think of?
I'd like to thank everybody that came out to support me, especially Team Trent and Vanda, good friends of mine. I hope they're the best. And thank you guys, thank your family. I love y'all. Love everybody out here supporting me. I'll see y'all later.
Ladies and gentlemen, Jeremy Lights Out McLaurin!
So there he is, Jeremy McLaurin. No, didn't pull any punches and just, you know, thank the crowd. You know, it'll be interesting to see because he talked about the fight with Gary Ayer, and that was a good little scrap. And I think that down the road, we might see those two tangle again. And it was there's so many times in this game you see, especially younger guys, that call somebody else. And whether or not they're ready for them, doesn't matter. In their head, they think they are. And, you know, sometimes when we saw it in 2007, as the band of Bonsante thing just percolated for a couple of years and it finally exploded and we got what we got. I think that that's a good thing. And I asked you guys in the last one of these little ditties we did, what you miss. Do you miss the fight or do you miss the feeling building up to that? And I think Jake hit it on the head when he talked about that's the feeling you're looking for. And as we walk up to Band of Truax in about an hour and a half, 2 hours, are we there? I mean, or is it, will we never have that again? Because it's tough to recreate that.
I don't know. For a lot of these guys, we're getting back to the house. A lot of kids are going to tell everybody at the same time, he's quite young, he's not a great fighter, not a lot of fighters. So there's only a couple of guys in your weight class
right,
that are worth fighting, so you got to call some guys out because it's like, well, you each got a small fan base. It's the only way you're going to fight somebody that's similar talent where you've got a chance to win, make some money, and then get the fan base excited, hopefully move up from there. As far as this fight with Vanda Truex, I think it's got a chance to be a really good fight. I think it's going to be a terrific fight, actually. But I don't think it has the build up that Bonsante Vanda, because Bonsante Vanda was something that everybody figured eventually was going to happen. And it built up for several years before they actually met, because they were both kind of going about doing their own thing. And then finally it was, well, it's about time. It's only, you know, it's a good fight. We can both make a couple of dollars. We have nothing else right at the moment. Let's do it. This fight, I don't think Truax wanted it for a long time. Not that he was, you know, he was ducking Vanda, but my point was, it wasn't really going to do him any good. He, you know, to fight Vanda, he was trying to climb up that ladder and get that national fight. But now it's a perfect fight for him. He needs to keep working. And if he's going to take that, you know, after he knocked out Taylor, the national fight scene is watching Truax now, and they don't want to see him beat up the Dwayne Wisdoms of the world anymore.
Right.
He's got to fight some. Vanda's got a name nationally. All matchmakers and promoters know Matt Vanda. So if you beat Vanda, and if you beat him decisively, he knocks him out. I got a feeling if Caleb wins tonight, especially by knock, but I think if he wins anyways, I think he's probably got a big payday coming up.
Absolutely.
I think he's got something big, whether it's a rematch with Taylor or another top 10 contender. But I just kind of get that feeling, and I've been hearing some rumors, and I don't know if you've heard of them too, that if he wins, there might be an announcement shortly after the fight that something big is going to happen. So I'm curious to see what that might be.
Well, and I'm excited for it. We'll see. We got a ways to go before we get there tonight. Kenneth Glenn and Damian Hill is... You see Hill entering the fray as we get set for our second bout of the night. 4 rounds in the junior middleweight division. And Damian Hill making his pro debut. And the butterflies and all that stuff, he's got all that stuff working. And
let's head up. Captain America trunks, too.
Absolutely. The ring announcer, Mike Miller.
Minnesota, this next bout will be 4 rounds in the junior middleweight division. Introducing first, in the red corner, standing 5 feet, 6 inches tall, weighing in at 152 pounds, and fighting out out of Minneapolis, Minnesota. He is representing the Spartan Martial Arts and holding a record of 1 win, 0 losses with 1 knockout. Ladies and gentlemen, he is a staff sergeant in the United States Army. I bring to you Ken Deeser. In the blue corner, standing 5 feet, 9 inches tall, weighing in at 156 pounds, and fighting out of Dayton, Minnesota. He's representing Valhalla Combat Sports and making his professional boxing debut, David Captain America Hill.
So it's Damian Hill making his pro debut and Kenneth Glenn. And how can you root against a staff sergeant in the U.S. Army who moonlights in a boxing gym? Or a boxing gym? Scheduled for 4 rounds. I like the way Glenn's built. He's put together, stocky. Where are those black and red trunks? Damian Hill making his pro debut. These guys are getting after it early on. Like the Captain America trunks, not to be confused with the fight we had a few years back, the comic book pattern trunks.
And those were just briefs, tiny whiteys with comic books. It was most comical on fight I've ever seen.
It's on YouTube. Yeah. It's good stuff.
And I think it landed about 8 seconds.
Yeah, it was one of the quickest knockouts in boxing history. Bill Drill Williams. Nice overhand right by Damian Hill. You talk about all the things, Dan, that you have to work through when you make your pro debut. You know, Caleb talked to me about early on in his career, you're worried about all the tickets and people come up to you and asking for everything, and then you. Oh, by the way, you got to fight too. So you got all that stuff happening. And then there's the emotion. When you're in the ring, it's just you and the other guy and the ref. And let's go.
These guys right here, I guarantee you. I'll say I guarantee you for a fact, but I'll still guarantee you. Promoter guy gained some tickets and said, go off the subway. That's how they make part of that city. They want to sell tickets. They can bring fans into the stands. They can make a bigger person. So you're right. There are a lot of other things I'm in mind. There's nothing on Command and Truex. They're just fighting with the other guys. Yeah, absolutely. These younger guys got a lot to think about.
Damian Hill in the Captain America trunks and Michael Glenn, or Kenneth Glenn, rather. And again, a distinct height advantage in a camp of Hill. As this is the first round of 4. Busy early, and now just kind of sizing each other out. Hill sends the jab out there to test the waters. There's a nice combo. Sent the jab out there, then sent the uppercut. Didn't land, but back comes Glenn as he's got him into the corner right in front of us. Back pedal and reset.
You can see just by... Had you not known their records, you can see that they're real raw. The footwork's not real good. Kind of just stalking each other flat-footed, waiting for an opening. And once you see one, just go in and start throwing leather. Which is okay. You got to start somewhere.
That's right. Nearing the end of round number 1. Doug Erlein alongside of Dan Cole, Pete Wagner driving the ship. The Minneapolis Convention Center, and we've reached the end of 1. Well, you get that first one out of the way. Now you can go to work.
You like making your debut in
four rounds.
Standing up, going back
like
to the court.
Glenn's built.
And have another round of fight.
As opposed to the alternative, it is a good thing.
That's what I was worried about. Captain America has got that shield on his trunks, the old Captain America shield, and I'm just afraid he's going to go out on his shield,
right,
which he doesn't want to do.
No. The Ring Girls tonight brought to you by Little Caesars Hot and Ready Pizza. $5, Pete Wagner, and not a bad thing. Not a, that's about as good of a bar. Yeah, no, not the Ring Girls, the pizza. Now you're good. So now if you're in the corner, Dan, what are you talking about? Is that what you're saying? Look, breathe, you made it through one, let's go.
I would say just keep doing what you're doing. I mean, I'm sure these guys aren't pro a jab, you know, do this, do that, but so far so good, I think, for both fighters. Both fighters look good, pretty even round.
Both try to fire the jab early. And a nice overhand right by Kenneth Glenn with 1-0 record. These guys, young fighters. Nice job by Hill, has him working backwards.
He's getting aggressive, Damien. Your counter punch is out. Big leg, put two in his face.
Oh, there's a nice right hand by Damien Hill. A nice jab there by Hill, followed that one up. Damien Hill out of Minneapolis. Both these guys out of Minneapolis. Nice job by Glenn. Had him back towards us.
Yeah, both guys are pretty flat-footed. Almost fight. Young kids especially get impatient. They're not into working the jab, work the jab, work the jab, go downstairs. So they kind of throw the jab occasionally, but they're looking to try to throw a big haymaker, hurt the guy, get inside. There's a good right hand there.
We're going to give the crowd what they want. I do like the patience of these guys, though. You know, it's kind of one of those things that's early on. You gotta try to, you know, I would assume, and I've never been in the ring, but I would assume that you get everything going, you get the adrenaline, and the first thing you think about is just rushing in and just start throwing. And both these guys just patient and just waiting for their opening. There hasn't been a lot through two rounds.
That's why they call it boxing, not brawling. And a lot of fights turn into a brawl, but you're supposed to be a boxer. You're supposed to have a strategy coming in. You're supposed to work a jab, establish that, keep the guy at arm's length, and then once he gets tired of getting fed a steady diet at the jab, you start throwing combinations, crosses, and flips. Next thing you know, you're piling up points.
Glenn doing a good job right in front of us, working the body moments ago. Pace is slow. Had a mouthpiece, lost his mouthpiece. It's on the table. The referee doesn't know.
Another right hand.
And Glenn's got him in the corner. His time runs out here in round two.
Yeah, heel's hurt. He's hanging on. I think he's going to get out of the round, but he was certainly staggered. It was a really good right hand.
Yeah, that
he's even, he's having trouble getting to the corner.
Yeah, that right hand sent his mouthpiece flying onto the table right in front of us. Well, I like, again, we talked about it. I like what Glenn did. He was patient. He picked his spot. And here you're going to see right in front of you here the replay. And this is where Hill, his mouthpiece went a-flying. And Glenn tried to finish the deal, and Hill just hung on. Round number three, this one's been entertaining. A pro debut for Hill, and Glenn making his second overall start. We'll see if Hill keeps the pressure, Glenn rather, keeps the pressure on.
I think I actually did see Glenn fight. He fought at that Canterbury, didn't he? Wasn't that his debut?
I think it was. I think you're right. We get that military discipline too. There's something to be said for that. Hill appears to have cleared the cobwebs and back on the offensive.
And you know, back in the military, I don't know if they still do this, but boxing was a big part of your military training. My dad was in the Army. He boxed. A lot of guys would come out of the service and turn pro. They'd learn how to fight while they were in the service. My dad told me he was stationed in the Philippines and he fought for the camp championship in his weight division and said he got knocked out. I don't remember the name. He didn't win the title. Won a couple of fights leading up to it, but he lost. He said he just got killed by some guy. Don't remember a thing.
That's a nice shot by Hill coming back. Round three. Dan Cole, Doug Rehlein, ringside here at the convention center. And just a beautiful crowd here to support Minnesota boxing. And what has been dubbed the biggest fight in Minnesota boxing history. I'll let others decide that. It's going to be a hell of a war, that's all I know.
Yeah, it's got a chance to be a really good fight. I don't know if it's the most highly anticipated fight. You got to promote your fight.
Right.
Certainly, in recent memory, the only one I think that really was Vanderbilt Sanchez,
right.
And this is close to
them. And the common denominator, obviously, is Matt Vanda, and the mouthpiece goes flying again. Hill is in trouble, and this time Glenn's got a little bit more time with which to work, and they got a timeout here. That hurt. That shot to the body. Hurt Hill. I like what Glenn's doing here. I really do. Nice shot to the body, and that mouthpiece went flying. That one just about landed in the front row.
Well, Glenn, and you notice right away from the start of this round, his mouth is gaping open. He's winded. He's hurt. He's getting by and just got some determination. His toughness right now. The old pride.
Yep.
Right?
Glenn has him into the corner.
Yeah, Glenn's having his way with him now. You can see referee Scott Erickson is taking a pretty good look here.
Hill trying to hang on. He's got 10 seconds in which to do it to survive for yet another round. But Kenneth Glenn.
I think Hill's almost asking
for
the fight to be stopped. He's had plenty. I wouldn't even know.
Well, that's tough, you know. I mean, what do you do? It's more of a...
I wouldn't even be surprised if Scott Erickson didn't stop the fight.
We'll see what direction they go.
Well, I'll make another prediction, or is this my first? I don't think he'll finish the fight off. No. I don't think he's got 3 minutes in him. Scott Erickson's a younger referee as far as the pro ranks go. He's been doing Golden Glove for years. I think it's a year or so now. He's been doing pro fights and he's getting to become a really accomplished referee.
Well, if you're Hill and your rookie giving your pro debut, here's where you got to dig deep. 3 minutes. And it's an intestinal fortitude thing.
And if I'm his corner, I'm telling him not to be standing flat-footed like that.
Right.
He should be on his toes, moving, trying to get away. I mean, I know he's got to throw back punches too, but he should be trying to get away from Glenn's left hand, because Glenn's really starting to do something. He's just loading up.
Yeah, for sure. And Minnesota middleweight Robert Brandt in the corner of Kenneth Glenn. And Brandt's going to be one of those kids that you're going to want to watch over the next few years. I think he's got something special. They want the mouthpiece again. Oh, he's just gassed. Glenn, does Glenn have the gas, the juice?
I'd stop this. Yeah. There's no sense to even let it go on.
Just completely completely out of gas.
Yeah, I would just wave the fight off. It won't be long now.
Final round of this one.
Like you say, it seems like it's mostly a fatigue factor. It's not as though Hill is,
right,
you know, has been beaten with the post. He just doesn't have any left, and he's not offering much offensively either.
Is that a training thing, or is that, you know, a conditioning thing, getting ready?
Maybe a little bit, you know, first fight. I don't know. Maybe I'm assuming he was fighting out of something like an MMA camp. So maybe he's an MMA fighter, and he's. It's a little bit of a different of a game. MMA, you can jump on a guy and hold him on his hands for a minute or two. You've got to keep moving.
Glenn working the body again right in front of us. And he's about a mile ahead in points. And so if you're Hill, you got to try to reach back and find some magic.
I think at this point, Hill just wants to finish the fight on his feet, make his pro debut on his feet. I think it's, well, he'd have to really catch Glenn with a big punch to change the direction of this fight. Hit him with the left hand there, but it didn't do much effect at all.
Neither of these guys on cruise control, but it's always interesting to watch these younger fighters too. You know, just because it's a process. It is. I mean, you get a guy like Banda that's been in nearly 60 wars. And it wasn't always, you know, I mean, it's a routine, and you learn, and you figure it out, but it takes time. Both these young guys are going to learn a ton as they continue their career, if that's the path that they want to go.
Yeah, it's a lot like, here's a comparison I'll make for you, even though it might be a stretch, 10 seconds to go. I guess I was wrong. I owe Damian Hill an apology. Looks like he's going to finish the fight on his feet. Yeah, you can tell he's pleased to have done so. I was going to say, though, sort of like being an auto racer, when to put on the gas,
yep,
when to let off it a little bit. That's what you're talking about, where you watch guys like Banda, Bonsan, any of the guys, really talented fighters, Truax. They know when, you know, if they've expended a lot of energy and they've done something, then they have to back them because they got to catch them over and pace themselves because they don't want to throw themselves up. They got to know when to put on the gas and when not. And those guys know how to
do it. Yeah, pace them.
Before 10 rounds, I mean, think about it, it's 30 minutes in the ring and then a minute and 3 to 45 minutes. It's not like basketball where you put it in your hand and get a blow and the coach puts you on somebody in for you. There's no service to fight. But I like Kenneth Glenn. I think he's got some talent. He's got a long way to go, but he gets throws some pretty nice combinations. I'd like to see him move around a little bit more, get on his toes.
Yep.
But he's a good fighter. I think he's got some talent.
As we wait for the official decision, our co-main event tonight, it's going to be a dandy. We saw Travis Brzezinski in the last fight. That was the fight of the night in his last contest with Tyler Holt. And he's going to face Sir Charles Meyer. And Charles told me last night in the weigh-in, and this is unofficial, and he hasn't made up, this might be his last fight.
Really?
Yeah, he may be done. And he's 39, you know, and so I joke with him all the time because that's the same age I am. And I said, you got to represent us 39-year-olds well.
Right.
And, you know, and he's only 6-2-2, so he's only got, you know, Minnesota math tells me that's 10 fights.
Yeah.
But you get to a point and you're like, well, you know, I got two kids at home, and is this what I want to do, and how much work it is to get ready. And so we'll see. But
yeah,
it'll be a good fight.
He's certainly not going on bigger and better.
No.
Things are much bigger and better. And the Brzezinski's kid is tough.
Yeah,
he's tough as nails.
I like him a lot.
I do too.
We await the decision from the judges. I anticipate probably a similar result as we had the last one. And again, what do I know?
Just so you know, the Kenneth Glenn kid's a big fan.
I like him. Well, who's not?
Well, the guy sitting to my left isn't. I don't think he's a big common man fan.
Mike Melick has our decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, after the completion of four rounds, the judges have made their decision.
Judge Mariano scoring at 39-36. Judge Jim Perrault scoring at 39-36. And Judge Tim Taggart scoring at 40-34. The winner by unanimous decision, Ken Lisa!
So Glenn moves to 2-0. We'll see if.
You know, and if he continues on this path, he's going to get better, work better, and work those punches together a little bit better. That's a fight he'll finish it. Yeah. You know, with some more experience, you've given up a handful of fights, so I think we're going to get a Damien Hill out. And Damien Hill's got a lot of work, too. You know, he's got to take a look at himself and say, his fight game's tough because he was definitely tougher. I mean, he was spent by the third round.
And like the first round, or like a round and a half. I mean, because he lost his mouthpiece the first time right in front of us in the second. And then lost again in the second or the third and the fourth. Let's go up top and get a listen.
Ken, does it change the way you train at all? You know, getting ready for a boxing fight compared to a mixed martial arts fight?
Yeah, most definitely. You know, we come from the mixed martial arts gym. Obviously, it's different from the boxing gym. But my coach John Tracy, he did a good job getting me in track to Kaczynski. Ready, you know, he focused training on boxing, he had boxing rounds, studied a lot of tape, a lot of boxers, President City, Jack Johnson, everybody. You know, we just tried to get our boxing savvy up so we can come in there strong.
And you and Damien have fought before in a different kind of way. Anything you'd like to say to him?
Yeah, man, much respect to Damien. I know he caught me with a good shot in the last April, so it's kind of getting in here and spreading it up. I love to do it every day again too, but yeah, man, it's good stuff.
Well, great job, Staff Sergeant. Anyone you'd like to thank tonight?
Yeah, definitely. Thanks to Greg Lowe, Omega Presents Promotions. Appreciate the opportunity. Thanks, Robert, Travis, my coach. Thank you for all you guys coming out tonight. Show us much love. We really appreciate it. We would be here for one of y'all. So much love to everybody here. And the beautiful message. This is me. Love you, baby.
Ladies and gentlemen, give it up for the Staff Sergeant, the gentleman, Ken DeSalle-Glenn.
So, Ken Glenn picks up the win, and he's 2-0 in his young career. You heard him. Dan talked about him. When you train in an MMA gym, that's exactly what we kind of had. And I believe. So initially out of the game, he's going to be an intermission at this point. I think we're going to, what's that? So that's fine. We get going a little late. The sooner we keep rolling here. They wanted three intermissions, and that just ain't going to happen that long. So we continue now.
Yeah, I wouldn't do three.
Well, that's what they were. They were going to do twice.
Why? You want to show up for sessions?
Well, if they had the cash registers working. Missed opportunity. Have you seen this guy to my left eat? I know you did.
He was here for food. He's working for food. And that's what he was
doing. Yeah, exactly. All right, so our third bout of the evening, Tony Too Sharp Lee and Leonard Overstreet out of Davenport, Iowa, is 0-2. And Overstreet will hit the ring first. And Tony Lee, who's a real slick fighter, and back in the ring. And I think if he gets some good direction, Dan, I think Tony Lee's got an opportunity to do something special too.
Yeah, Tony's an interesting case. He's a very slick fighter. He lost to the fighting Chihuahua.
That was a great fight.
And
by the way, that's the best ring name in boxing right now.
There's not many better.
No.
I mean, my favorite of all time was always Bobby Boogaloo Watts, but fighting Chihuahua is pretty good too. And that's the fight, the Chihuahua always comes to fight. He's very slick, but he loses almost every fight. And so I think that was pretty disappointing for Tony to lose that fight. That's not a fight you're supposed to lose. You know, that's an early on fight, learning experience. That was a setback. But since then, he's got a turnaround again. Three knockouts and six wins. Can't afford a loss, really. You know, and I wouldn't expect him to lose to Leonard Overstreet tonight. But yeah, I think Tony's got a chance to be a pretty good fighter. It's going to be interesting to see what happens.
So here comes Too Sharp. Entering the fray on a cold January night. As we get ready to witness boxing history, the man is Truax to battle about an hour and 15 from now. Yet to come, John the Iron Man Schmidt back in action. He'll battle Michael Falk. That'll be a war. Muhammad Kyango, 15-2. And Gilbert Venegas, that one might steal the show. I think that's going to be a great scrap. This card, top to bottom, is not a bad thing. And I think as we continue to move along here, it's only going to get better as Tony Lee climbs those steps, will step between the ropes. Johnny Johnson holds them open for him. Mark Nelson, the official. The participants have entered.
Tony's got a good veteran corner. Johnny Johnson, Alex Gage. Otis was a really good fighter in his own right. I like Otis a lot.
I do too.
Along with Otis, really good. He's really Otis Gage is engaging, fun, and he's got a great sense of humor. Real calm, cool, collected. He's a great guy to have in your corner. I think if things start to go bad, I don't think he's ever going to get too excited and know what's going to get to him. And you got to have that in your corner. You have to have a guy that. I mean, Stern tells you what to do, but you got to have a guy that stays
calm. All right, Minnesota, this next bout will be four rounds in the lightweight division. Introducing first, in the red corner, sitting 5'8" tall, weighing in at 142 pounds, and fighting out of Davenport, Iowa. He's representing Pena's Gym. And holding a record of no wins and two losses, Leonard the Hitman Overstreet. And his opponent in the blue corner, sitting 5'8" tall, weighing in at 143 pounds, and fighting out of the west side of St. Paul, Minnesota. He's representing Element Boxing and holding a dangerous record of 6 wins, 1 loss with 3 Tony Ducharme.
Yeah, baby!
He's just too sharp.
He's too sharp.
I love the nickname.
I do too. So the height advantage goes to Tony Lee. 6-1 with 3 knockouts. And Leonard Overstreet, 0-2, looking for his first win as a professional fighter. And we're underway. This one's scheduled for 4. Tony Lee in the red and black trunks, and Overstreet in the red and white. Overstreet, as you see, with a straight up and down style. Tony trying to pick his spot, looks in.
Nice body shot by Overstreet.
Absolutely. Tony comes back as Overstreet tries to get inside again.
Hands free, guys. Get out of the corner.
I'll throw the center of the ring, buddy. Let's get back out of the ring.
Overstreet sends an overhand right.
Step up.
And a return by Tony Lee. Lee sets that left out there to test the water. And now he sends an overhand right, right down the middle. Boy, the difference in movement here is, as opposed to what we saw in our last fight, night and day.
Watch your hands again, guys. I know.
Yeah, well, Tony had a nice hand earlier, too. He's had a lot of fights, a lot of experience, really talented. Real slick ones. I like slick-looking fighters. I like guys that can stick and move and stay on their toes and throw the jab and go upstairs and downstairs. He's the whole package. He can fight. He's a boxer.
And he's cut above his left eye, and I think it was an incidental headbutt. Mark Nelson takes a look in, and Overstreet sends a right hand. That was a head. It was a clash of the heads early on, and there is blood trickling from the left eye of Tony Lee.
It seems to be on the outside a little bit, not right above, so hopefully it won't bother him too much. It's not above the brow, sort of in the corner of the eye. We'll see.
Why are we waiting? Why are we waiting, man? Get a stick!
Go,
It's interesting. Mark Nelson told me before this started, he said, don't worry about it. I'll let you know if something happens inside the ring. And what he meant by that is if there was an incidental headbutt, he was going to let us, you know, they just, and that's what an official of his caliber will do. You know, and not just for, you know, for us, you know, to let us know what's going on. Is he's got control of this thing, and it's a pleasure to be able to work with him.
Well, for instance, I know what he would have done in the last one. When Damian Hill hit his knees, he was starting counting.
Yeah.
There you go. If you're not on the soles of your feet, you got to start counting. Because he was basically, with the mouthpiece on, he was giving himself a break by getting down on his knees, and you can't do that.
Overstreet with the bounce. And we've reached the end of round one.
Now we'll get to see what kind of a cut man Johnny Johnson is. He and his cage will get to work on the cut right now. Notice is going to work on the arm will be Johnny.
So you can take a look at the replay here. And you get a look into Tony Lee's work on that cut. As the ring girls, hot and ready, brought to you by Little Caesars, firing t-shirts into the crowd. Get a good look at it there.
Seconds to start working on that cut. I'm a little surprised that they just now started putting some mass on whatever motion there it was. I'm a little surprised it took them that long to start working on the cut on Tony's eye.
Confidence in the Overstreet camp as we start round number two. Like Tony coming out, firing a couple jabs out there.
Looks like there's a bit of a welt below the left eye now.
But both guys, and they just did it again there. They both lean in and they clash heads. It's the third time that's happened in this fight. Boy, Overstreet, a guy that's 0-2.
Well, I like Tony a lot, but I've never watched a really overwhelming, he's been overly impressive. Wow, and this guy's electric. He's a good fighter. He needs a fight one. He needs to beat this Overstreet kid. And you get a cut on your eye, and all of a sudden it starts to bother you, and then hopefully we'll get desperate here because it is only a four-rounder. But he's got to get busy here, and he's got to start landing some punches because Overstreet does. I mean, he's obviously got to feel confident. Comes up here, he's already got him cut, even if it was an accidental headbutt.
Right uppercut, Tony.
He certainly isn't backing down at all.
Nice shots to the body, Overstreet's corner. And you're right, a welt underneath the eye, the left eye of Tony Lee.
And now Overstreet, I don't know, we know not much about him in his amateur career, how long it was, but if he's crafty, I'd be telling his corner, hit that eye as often as possible. Be my only target right now.
Yeah,
go downstairs to mix it up a little bit, to bring his hands down, but I'd be going to that right side of that face. Right. Nice combination by Tony.
Great combination by Lee.
Touchdown. Bring that touchdown again. It's right there, Joe. Watch the foot. It's there.
6-1 is Tony Lee's record. And Overstreet hanging right with him. Oh, there's a nice uppercut.
Really nice uppercut, right on the button, on the jaw.
That one couldn't have been measured any better by Tony Lee. And Lee sends him backwards once again.
Maybe cut guy knew what he was doing. Yeah. He took his time because he knew it wasn't a bad cut because it has not opened back up again.
Nope.
Really nice job. Some great cutman work over here because it's not bleeding at all. Now it looked like a pretty good match too.
Final 10 seconds of round number two. And that's the end of round two.
Yeah, I guess I gotta apologize to cutman.
The cut's from a headbutt. The swelling's a punch. Just for later.
So the cut was certainly a headbutt, right. But the welt below the eye was from a punch on me.
So round number three, and Tony Lee comes out firing. This one's scheduled for four.
And really should. If I'm Tony Lee's corner, I'd say, you got to step it up. You got to take command. You got to show him who's boss. Boy, they're both flurrying there.
You're dead.
You're dead.
You're dead.
You're dead.
You're dead.
You're dead.
You're dead. You're dead.
You're dead. You're dead.
Fighters tie up here. Leonard Overstreet. And Tony Too Sharp.
Great, don't punch.
Wilson steps in and gets the guy separated.
Come on, Tony, it's there. Tony, don't stop.
Sends that left hand. The corner took up Leonard Overstreet, not happy with that last exchange.
This gonna work. This gonna work.
This old man has no business in the ring with you. Let's go. There you go.
Well, it seems to me Overstreet doesn't feel like Lee can
hurt.
Right. Now he hit him with an uppercut right on the button, and it fades Overstreet. And I think he kind of thinks that. He can take pretty much anything from his cards to deliver.
These guys standing toe-to-toe here in round number three.
Right left, right down the middle. Right left, right down the middle. It's there. Right left, right.
Sends a shot over the top.
Right left, right. Down the middle.
Guys just send the uppercut. Things have slowed down here towards the middle part of round number three, which is good news if you're Overstreet, as you figure you're ahead.
I'm top.
Tony's got to put the pressure on now.
Right hand, left hook.
There comes Tony firing. Nice job by Overstreet with the tie up. 10 seconds left in round number three. And that's the end of round three.
I think Tony got the better of him in that round.
Yep.
As a matter of fact, I think Tony won the first round as well, even though he got a headbutt. I think Tony's leading two rounds to one right now. Who knows how the officials see it. It's very close. You can see it going either way. I'm assuming, well, I know they're all working. Every round is being scored on a 10-point plus.
Right. You take a look at the replay here. Tony Lee. And now you're going to look at the hot and ready ring girl. Pete Wagner driving the ship. Knows right when to flip the switch, right?
He submits him.
Absolutely. Our third fight of the evening.
Second time.
7-all. Final round of this one. Tony Lee and Leonard Overstreet. And we're underway.
Tony doesn't want another Jesse Roscoe.
No,
he doesn't either. He needs to really step it up and finish strong here and show the judges who deserves to win. I still think, now there's a warning about watching the two of them. The cut was an accidental butt.
Yep.
Right, left, right, Tony.
And now Tony Lee goes back to work. Catches a flush on the chin. Moves him back. Both fighters throwing punches here in round number four. Catches him with an overhand right.
And again, Tony Lee getting the better of the exchanges. Yep. And he's landing the more effective blows. Nice right hand.
Right down the middle. Right down the middle, baby. Too sharp. Right down the middle, Tony. Right down the middle. Right hand down the middle. There you go.
Well, he teed that one up. Overstreet just ducked. You talk about guys looking for that home run shot. And that's what Lee seems to be doing here.
All Tony needs to do is continue to do what he's doing right now the rest of the round. He's a better boxer. He's a better fighter. He's landing the better punches. They might not be any harder than Leonard Overstreet's punches, but they're better punches. They're crisper. They're straighter. They're landing with more authority.
Work! It's going to work!
Boy, lunged at him and Overstreet just about countered and came back.
Tony, will you go to work now? Quit playing. 30 seconds, Tony. 30 seconds.
30 seconds left in this round, in this fight. They're just standing toe-to-toe here in the middle of the ring. Overstreet's camp yelling, he's tired, he's tired. The problem is, so is he. Oh, nice shot by Overstreet.
1-2, right down the middle. Again. Push him off. Push him off.
Get off him, guys. Come on.
Nice left hand by Tony out of the break.
Yep.
Watch your hand. Come on. Okay, 10 seconds.
Oh, nice job by Lee. Caught him there. And that'll do it. That was a good little scrap.
Yeah, you can tell Tony's disappointed. I think he won the fight. I think he did enough to win the fight, but you can tell he's disappointed. I think Overstreet's delighted to, because he fought well. It was a nice fight for him, too. I think Tony was hoping to be a bit more dominant in that fight than he was. Porter did a great job of keeping that cut from being a factor in the fight, kept the swelling down under his eyes.
So we await the official decision.
I got a 39-27, closer.
Let me remind you again that tonight's official ad department will be at the courthouse. Even if you're not planning on going, I want to make sure all of you have it memorized. So if someone visits this and they ask you, you can tell them the official after party will be at the courthouse.
Official decision. Let's go up to Mike Mellon.
Judge Taggart scoring at about 39-37. Judge Perrault scoring at 40-36. And Judge Nelson scoring at 39-37. The winner by unanimous decision, Tony
Thank you.
two guys thought the same way. Two judges.
Great fight, Tony. I know you got some people out there you want to thank.
Yes, I do. I'd like to thank my family. First and foremost, I'd like to thank God. Just trying to get back into this. I've been on for a year. A little bit of shock coming up to me, but I pushed through it. I'm just blessed. Just want to thank everybody for coming out and helping the love. Thank you for saying tonight.
Well, great job, Tony. One more time, ladies and gentlemen. Show some love, Tony Tucson Lee.
You know, it's interesting. We got Tony Lee, who's not fought in a year. You got Muhammad Kayango coming up a little bit later on, who's fought in 2 years. You've got Jeremy McLaurin, who's had some time off. It isn't easy when you jump back in and you've been at a certain point and you expect just to jump back in and be there and you're not. And so, it's interesting that that
fish.
Is a little bit of subplot as we continue to run along here tonight.
Yeah, there's a question in mind for us with all that. You can't replicate what happens in the ring, but you're here. So, generally speaking, you don't see a lot of that.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we will be taking an intermission right now. But at this time, I'd like to welcome the National Karate School from Minneapolis and St. Paul, Minnesota. They got an exhibition challenge.
If you go back, I don't know if it still does now, but I'm sure as you know, back in the 60s and the 70s, they would say some of the sparring sessions that they would have in the gyms in Philadelphia were better than the fights themselves because guys would carry grudges and they'd want to be king of the gym.
Yep.
And these guys, they'd go at it gym toe-to-toe and go through wars, and they would be better fights than what you'd see when you go to the Blue Horizon. But, so to have some room rust and try to pick up, I mean, too sharp wasn't too sharp. He was sharp enough. But the thing with Tony, too, is he's not a power puncher.
Right.
So you saw him land a lot of punches there, and he didn't seem to really... Overstreet was no worse for the wear, and you can't really teach power, I don't think. I mean, there's a few things you can do, but you can either knock a guy out or you can't, but Tony's a talented fighter. There's no reason to stop at 7-1. So, yeah, it was a good fight for him, but you could see he was disappointed because I think he really wanted to dominate Overstreet. I don't think he felt like he did.
Ashley Christensen.
We've got a karate exhibition in the ring.
So a bit of a break here.
Indeed, a little bit of a break. We'll turn you loose a little bit.
I'm gonna go see if I talked to Vanna before the fight.
See if we can get a hold of Caleb.
I'll be right back.
The Mean Gene Okerlund of the Joint, Dan Cole, gonna go back and try to find him.
We got five judges. The majority of the judges are the ones that get the call. Smashed. Who do you like?
Score.
White. Number two.
Stop.
Scar. Not enough. Time. Time's been called. At the end of the first round, we've got the red corner, 4. The white corner, 2. These ladies, a round of applause, please. Thank you. Up next, we have the gentleman fighting out of the red corner. He's 22 years of martial arts experience. He's an international competitor and sponsored by Team Full Circle. He's a director of the Hawk International Karate, Mr. Hamid Ferruzi. Fighting in the white corner, he's got 28 years experience, 5th-degree black belt. One of the highest ranking national competitors on the circuit, Mr. BJ Carnahan.
Karate School.
back here at the Minneapolis Convention Center, Doug Erlein, Dan Cole, and we found our way somehow through the intermission, and we're ready to go. Mike Falk and John Schmidt. And Schmidt's been out of the game for a little bit, and so we talked to him earlier about guys jumping back in and how they have a little bit of ring rust to push off, and Schmidt's going to have to work through that as well. This is a fight that almost happened in the last card, and Michael Falk, no stranger to the local fight game. He's been in the gyms and all that stuff, and he's 2-2 with one knockout as he hits the ring with his team here tonight to face the Iron Man, John Schmidt. And it's interesting because these guys, you know, not that they train in the same gym, but Mike Falk's a guy that's been, it seems like he's been around, and I think he only has four fights. It's just kind of one of those, you just automatically think you've seen the guy around that he would have more than four pro starts.
Most of these guys, they gotta work for a living. Whether they're single or not,
right,
family or not, they gotta work for a living, working 8 hours a day, 50 weeks out of the year. It's hard to blend in your boxing, your training, find opponents, the right card, the right time. So some guys aren't as busy. And so I was just talking to a fan here. I think you and I have talked about this before. I probably say it every fight card we do. Matchmaking to me is the hardest part of a boxing card, because you've got to find guys that are equal in talent,
yep,
both coming to fight. A lot of times if both guys, that's like, for instance, why I think it took a while for Vanna Bonsante to fight, because fighting themselves did them no good nationally. They were both trying to do something. You don't want to lose to each other and collect losses. We'll save that for another day.
Right.
And the timing eventually happens. It's right for Truax now, and it's right for Vanda. But like here, yeah, you don't know how often guys get offers to fight, and they take them when they can.
So John Schmidt hits the ring, and Schmidt's ready to go.
Ladies and gentlemen, this next contest will be 6 rounds of the middleweight division. In the red corner, sitting 5 feet, 11 inches tall, weighing out at 160 pounds, and fighting out of St. Paul, Minnesota. He's representing Element Boxing and holding a record of 2 wins, 2 losses with a knockout. He is Mike the Professor Paul. And his opponent in the blue corner, standing 6 feet, 1 inch tall, weighing in at 160 pounds, and fighting at the Northeast Minneapolis, Minnesota. He's representing Mike's gym.
Going to be a war. This will be a flat-out brawl. As both fighters touch gloves and back to their respective corners, and we're set to go. This one's scheduled for 6 in the middleweight division. Mike Falk in the white trunks, Schmidt in the black and green, and we're underway. John Schmidt at 11-2. 6 knockouts in his professional career as Falk sends a shot to the body with the left hand. Now he's got Schmidt up against the rope. John trying to stick that jab out there. Early rounds here. And Schmidt, as we mentioned, with some time off in between his last fight.
Time.
As the official takes time. And Schmidt got his nursing degree as well.
Get his ass, John.
What are we going to have here?
I don't know. It's got to be a doctor.
have no idea what number Lee is.
Ringside doctor not here. He started the fight.
Ah.
He cannot conduct a fight in that ringside position. And I believe he left to tend to Tony Lee. He needed to. I heard Tony, as I went back to go talk to Caleb, told a couple of his fans, he said, I'll be right back. I got to go stitch up. So I think that put me in a stitch or two ringside positions back. So
here we go again. Mike Falk out of St. Paul, 2-2 with one knockout, and John Schmidt fighting out of Northeast Minneapolis at ACR Gym in Coon Rapids. Schmidt trying to find an opening to send that jab. It's interesting, and you talked about it, trying to weave fighting into the chosen career you go into, and when you're going to school for whatever it is, and in Schmidt's case, a nursing degree, as Falk sends an overhand shot to the head of Schmidt. I mean, just to go to school is a dedication in itself, and then you got to try to squeeze time to get to the gym. It's not an easy thing.
Generally, these guys need to fight most of them. 6 weeks of training, 6 weeks of
great.
And that's hard work. I mean, that's the road work, sparring, working a heavy bag, a speed bag, and there's a lot to do. It takes a lot of time.
Falk had Schmidt working backwards, and now John trying to hunt him down. Oh, there's a nice shot.